Okay, good afternoon, everybody. It's an honor to be here speaking about perhaps the future of space exploration. Okay, so the contents of this presentation deals with a so-called electric solar wind sail principle or concept, which is a new novel concept for moving around in the solar system without using propellant. I will start this by first discussing the physical principles behind it. So there are actually two different principles. There is a positive polarity effect and there is a negative polarity effect. And collectively these might be called the Coulomb drag phenomena, both of them. It's Coulomb drag because it's an electrostatic phenomenon. Then I discuss this positive polarity application for interplanetary propulsion, which we call the E-sail or electric sail. Then I will discuss the negative polarity application, which we call the plasma brake, which is meant to be used in the ionosphere or in low Earth orbit for deorbiting satellites. Then I will discuss two specific examples, two CubeSats, which are, one of them is flying already and the other one is being under preparation, Estonian and Finnish satellites. And then I will discuss applications of this electric solar wind sail, I mean interplanetary applications. Okay, so let's start from the physics. So, Coulomb drag effect, what does it mean? So, and especially the positive polarity Coulomb drag effect in this case. So, it means that if one puts a wire or tether which is charged by some means, by some technical means, which is charged and one puts it in flowing plasma, for example, into solar wind, which flows 400 to 800. Kilometers per second, as we know, then the question is what happens? So, and the answer is that what happens is that the plasma gets deflected by the electric field of this tether. Here is a particle in cell simulation result showing the density of ions and electrons. Of course, ions are mostly protons in this case because we are talking about the solar wind. And the coordinates here are just in kilometers, so the scale size of this structure which forms around this tether is a couple of hundreds of meters in this case with these parameters. Anyway, so what happens is that when the solar wind comes from the left, the ions get deflected, they will get pushed aside by the repulsion of the electric field of the tether, which is here at the middle, this white dot, and then one obtains a structure which looks at least qualitatively quite similar to the familiar magnetosphere what we have around the Earth. The only difference is that this is not the magnetosphere, of course, this is more like an electrosphere, if we want to use an analogous name. So this electrosphere forms and then, okay, ions behave like that, and then electrons, roughly speaking, they follow the behavior of the ions. But actually what electrons are doing is not so interesting for this practical application, because nearly all the momentum flux of the solar wind is in the protons, in the ions, because they are 1800 times heavier than electrons. And then that was a simulation, so and theory, but nowadays there are also some relevant laboratory measurements of this phenomenon. Not made by us, but made by people at Onera. Ziguer et al. Last year published a paper where they put a charged tether into flowing plasma. Their parameters were such that they were kind of mimicking the conditions in the ionosphere. And they used relatively small, low voltages, like 100 volts and 400 volts. And then they mapped the sheath structure around this wire by moving around a Langmuir, very small Langmuir probe, in this plane perpendicular to the tether. And here are the big results what they got. So here, this dot is the tether, and this plane is the perpendicular plane to the tether. Plasma flow comes from the right hand side, and then this white region here is the sheath behind, or wake behind the tether. So this white region is the same as this blue region, deep blue region here in the simulation. And then if one analyzes this data, I mean, if one just takes this dimension, this measures how many millimeters this sheath size is in this case with these parameters, then one obtains very good agreement actually with these theoretical results or simulation results what we have here. So the agreement is very good, especially if one assumes that there are no trapped electrons in the system. So by trapped electrons we mean that in principle if we have this kind of potential structure which is attractive for the electrons, if an electron loses energy for some reason, it might become trapped in this kind of potential well, and then it might circle around in this potential well for a long time before then maybe some collision or wave particle interactions or whatever slow process finally removes it. And by using these simulations, it's kind of difficult to say with certainty if there are this kind of trapped electrons, and if there are, how many and what happens to them. It's difficult because the time scales for these trapped electron removal processes are very long compared to typical time scales that one can reach in this kind of big simulations. But in this laboratory measurement, it's nice because the result is really consistent with a situation where we have no trapped electrons. So that makes life very simple if we can believe into that. And it's also nice because it means that the strength of this Coulomb-Bragg propulsion that we get from this phenomenon is maximal in some sense, because these trapped electrons, if they exist, they may shield electric field of the wire, which reduces the propulsive effect that we obtain to some extent. But if there are no trapped electrons, then we don't have to worry about it. Okay, so let's then go to discussing the negative polarity Coulomb-Bragg effects, which is in many ways similar, but also somewhat different. So this is again particle simulation result, and now the plasma flow is coming from the right-hand side in this picture. And we don't use solar wind parameters in this case, but we use the low Earth orbit parameters, similar to the data we had in the previous slide. And here is the electron distribution, here is the ion distribution. These ions are oxygen ions, by the way, in this case, because this is low Earth orbit. And what happens in this case is that because the tether is now negatively charged, it repels electrons. So there is an electron void, this blue region, around this wire, which is completely void of electrons. There is not even a single electron there because they don't have enough energy to penetrate into this region. But the opposite thing happens to ions. So ions are attracted by this wire, but in a similar way as a comet is orbiting the sun, for example. I mean, even though the sun is attracting it, it usually does not collide with the sun. So usually it just passes by in some hyperbolic orbit. So the same thing, similar thing happens here. So most of the ions just pass by the tether or wire. And these local enhancements in ion density, which are visible here, are kind of due to these ions, which are passing very near the wire. And then in this case, with these parameters, actually rather many of these ions, which arrive from the right-hand side, they are actually reflected back almost to the original incoming direction, which is very nice for us because it increases the propulsive Coulomb-Bragg effect that we get in this case with these parameters. And I would also like to add that in this case of negative polarity, we don't have to worry about these trapped electrons, obviously, because all the electrons are simply repelled by the tether. So in that sense, these simulation results should be like trustworthy for the case of negative polarity, even without confirmation from laboratory measurements in some sense. Okay, so now we have discussed the basic physics of this Coulomb-Bragg phenomena of a charged wire or charged ether in flowing plasma. So then there's a question that which polarity should we choose, because both seem to be possible choices. And the answer is that, well, there are certain technical reasons. I will not discuss them in detail, but the end result is that this positive polarity tether seems to be preferred in the solar wind conditions, while the negative tether polarity is preferred in low Earth orbit conditions. Having said that, in principle, other combinations are possible, so we might also, in theory, we might also use negative polarity in the solar wind and positive polarity in low Earth orbit conditions. Then some numbers to make this story kind of more concrete. So if we first discuss the positive polarity case, which we call the electric sail, E sail, in the solar wind. So then, in that case, we would typically use a couple of tens of kilovolts potential, let's say 20 kilovolts to be specific. And then if we do that, then we would expect to get about 0.5 millinewton per kilometer of tether of propulsive thrust in average solar wind at 1 AU distance. It's not very much, of course, but the thing is that this tether that we need to generate this amount of thrust is very, very lightweight. So 1 kilometer of tether only weighs 11 grams, as we have made it in the laboratory. And this thrust, it scales as 1/distance in the solar system. So it's not 1/distance squared, but it's really 1/distance. The reason is that the plasma debye length scaling. So the dynamic pressure goes down as 1/r squared, but then the debye length increases when you go outwards in the solar system, because the density goes down. So it effectively means that the effective sail area increases when you go outward in the solar system, and therefore this kind of partly compensates the decay of the dynamic pressure, which is the thrust source here. But then the power consumption of the system, I mean to maintain this charge of the tether, we need some technical means, and this technical means is, in practice, it's an electron gun which shoots away electrons from the spacecraft and keeps these structures positively charged. And this electron gun consumes some power, and this power consumption is like 0.7 watts per millinewton at 1 AU distance. It scales as 1/r squared, which is very nice, because then it scales in the same way as the power produced by solar panels. So it means that if one puts enough solar panels at 1 AU distance, then they are sufficient at outer distances as well. The negative polarity plasma break in the ionosphere, low Earth orbit conditions, then the thrust, specific thrust, is smaller. It's like 5 to 10 times smaller, typically. Also the voltage is much smaller. We are talking about 1 kilovolt, typically. Of course, all these numbers depend on the actual plasma density in the ionosphere, which varies. It depends on space weather rather strongly, and on altitude, and also the chemical composition, how much oxygen is in particular, how much oxygen there is in the ionosphere. But anyway, these are kind of typical average numbers. And the power consumption is also, well, it is something, it is not quite as favorable as the solar wind application, but it's anyway pretty good. And then if one really wants to kind of have a zeroth approximation for the physics, then one can think about this phenomenon in the following way. So the thrust per length of that the tether produces is essentially it's the dynamic pressure of the flow, which has units newtons over square meter, multiplied by some scale length, and the scale length is simply the Debye length of the plasma, but modified in such a way that in place of the electron temperature, one substitutes the voltage of the wire, voltage of the tether. So we can call this the effective Debye length if we want. So basically just calculate the effective Debye length, that gives the influence region of the tether or the sheath width, sheath dimension, and then multiply by the dynamic pressure, and that gives the thrust per unit length of tether. So this is very simple formula. Of course, this is not exact. So and the story is slightly different for negative and positive case, but this is kind of the zeroth approximation. Well, that if one just puts this kind of charged tether in flowing plasma, one obtains some thrust. Then the next question is that how to construct a spacecraft or a system in such a way that one can utilize this thrust. And one needs some way of keeping this tether stretched more or less perpendicularly to the plasma flow, because if one allows the tether to move freely without any restrictions, then it will sooner or later become parallel to the flow. So it will become like a windsock in the flow, and then after that it produces no thrust anymore. So one needs some active means of keeping this tether against the flow, so to say. And the centrifugal force seems to be the most simple way of accomplishing this. So we build a system which rotates, and it has radial, more or less radial tethers like that, which are charged, and each of these tethers produces thrust individually. Then we need some way to dynamically stabilize the system, and stabilization means that we must not allow for these tethers to collide with each other. And again, there are many ways to do it, but one of the simplest ways is that one connects these tips of the main tethers by something that we call the auxiliary tethers, whose purpose is just to connect the tips together mechanically, so that it helps keep them apart. And then if we do that, then we need some unit which we call the remote unit, which is some physical device at the junction of the main tether and the auxiliary tethers. I mean, we need this unit because we need some reels from which we reel out this auxiliary tether, and this remote unit is the place where these reels must be installed. And then we also need some kind of auxiliary propulsion system in the remote units to start the spin during the deployment phase, because now we are talking about very large systems. So in a full-scale ESL, this could be 20 kilometers. The length of the tether, and if one calculates how much angular momentum there is in this kind of system, although it rotates very slowly, maybe the rotation time is about 1 hour perhaps, the angular momentum is huge because the length of the tether is so large. So it's a large amount of angular momentum, and one has to obtain it somehow during deployment. But if one obtains it by applying some small amount of propulsion at the end of the tether, then that's a very efficient way of generating torque and generating angular momentum. So this is the basic framework. And then in terms of performance, I mean, one can wrap it up in such a way that we could obtain up to one newton of thrust from a device whose mass is less than 200 kilograms in this case. And 1 newton of thrust is enough to give 30 kilometers per second of velocity change per year to a 1-ton spacecraft. And then, so from this example, you see that now we consumed 200 kilograms from the propulsion system, so 800 kilograms is still free for the payload and the rest of the spacecraft. So it looks. Seems to be highly useful if this kind of device can be built, because it enables significant payloads to move freely in the solar system without consuming propellant and without temporal restrictions. We had some technical development of these ideas, and we had an EU project, FP7 project, and one of the main results of that project was that we were able to produce 1 kilometer piece of this tether, final type tether, which is really so thin that we can it meets these specifications what we gave here. So here is the picture of the tether. It's stored on 5 centimeter diameter reel. The weight of the mass of the tether is 11 grams. So that gives you this. If one opens that kilometer in space, it gives you a sail which produces 0.5 millinewton of thrust. Then we also demonstrated unreeling of this tether, I mean, without problems. Also after vibration test, so we made the tether, put it on the reel, like white model reel, and then put it to vibration facility, took it out, and then tested if it opens again, and it does. So it really works in that sense. Then also we prototyped and tested this remote unit. I mean, the remote unit is the device which is sitting at the end of each tether. This is purely engineering, so it's just a device which hosts these auxiliary tether reels, these two round things here, and then it has some thermal insulation, it has solar panels on one side, it has small gas thruster also inside for creating the initial spin. This work was mainly made in Sweden, at this remote network, Sweden and Germany and also Italy and Estonia. And then we also built some software, which we call Flight Simulator. I mean, program which computes, which solves Newton's laws, basically, to model the dynamics of these kind of tether systems or e-sail systems in space under realistic solar wind conditions. So we can take real solar wind measured by a satellite earlier and then run this simulator, flight simulator, using this historical solar wind data. I mentioned the tether production, so here is the tether factory. It's actually located in the neighboring building in the University of Helsinki. It uses ultrasonic bonding technique. So here is the core of the tether factory. It's a 30 centimeter long piece, tabletop device, which takes four input wires, which are just ordinary bulk wires that you can buy off the shelf, and then it produces one tether output to its output reel, which is here. So here is an image of the tether. It has one straight wire, and then it has three loop wires for redundancy. So the reason for these loop wires is micrometeoroid tolerance. So if one just puts one single wire in space, it doesn't live for a long time because it's cut by micrometeoroids. But if one makes this kind of tether, which contains these bonds and this redundancy, then this wire lifetime will be much increased, and it will become actually tens of years, even for thousands of kilometers long tether. And here is an electron microscope image of a single bond. So this is ultrasonic bond, a base wire, 50 micrometer base wire bonded to 25 micron loop wire. And the industrial production of these bonds is the main technical challenge in this project. And this problem has been largely solved by the people at University of Helsinki. So they made this work for the first time in the world. Everybody in the electronics industry applies ultrasonic bonding, but they always bond a wire to platform. But this is the only group in the world who bonds two wires together, two thin wires together by this ultrasonic technique, in a very repeatable, very, very high quality manner, so that the bonds are strong. They are strong. One doesn't lose much of the original strength of the wire, and they are also very repeatable. Then about this dynamical simulation, so it's really just solves Newton's laws for elastic bending wires. It includes the e-sail force and the real solar wind. And we can model different maneuvers with this this dynamical simulator. Okay, so now I discussed the E-sail, interplanetary, for interplanetary propulsion. Now I will discuss the plasma brake for deorbiting satellites. So in this case we use one single negative tether and we use gravity stabilization. So we just hang the tether vertically in orbit, stretched by the gravity gradient of the Earth. And then we could go up to 15 kilometer length, and there are some, here's some formula which I just wrote down for the reason that it's in very good agreement. I mean, this analytical formula is in surprisingly good agreement with the plasma simulations that we made. So it's not at all obvious that this is so, but if one does it, then kind of this formula condenses the plasma simulation results in a surprisingly good extent. But I mean, qualitatively, this is of the similar type as the earlier formula I showed. So we have the dynamic pressure, we have the effective debye length, then we have some small, well, some correction factor, which is actually close to unity in these parameters, and then some numerical coefficient in front of the whole thing. This device is already flying in space, so this was launched about 1 year ago on board the second Vega launch from Kourou. So by the so we have a small CubeSat there. It's Estonian CubeSat, but the payload is made by us mainly. So this is the real payload that we have. It's a single circuit board, CubeSat circuit board, 10 by 10 centimeters, and this thing here is the reel from which this 10 meter tether in this case will be opened. This is the satellite and this is the launch. Now we are waiting for the tether experiment still. There is some, I mean, the satellite works otherwise fine, but there is some something ferromagnetic, something little bit ferromagnetic on the satellite, which was a mistake, of course. I mean, there shouldn't be anything ferromagnetic on the satellite. Anyway, the Estonians are fiercely working around this problem by software. So they try to make the attitude control system working in a smooth enough way before we dare to spin up the satellite and open the tether. They have already been able to spin up the satellite, but it's still wobbling to some extent. So they want to reduce this wobble before this real experiment is carried out. So we are in the waiting mode regarding this. So after we open the tether, then if all goes fine, then we can measure the strength of the E-sail effect, actually both positive and negative polarity in orbit, in low Earth orbit conditions. There is also a backup, well, in some sense backup experiment, which is the Finnish CubeSat Aalto 1. It's not only backup because it's actually much more ambitious, so it uses 100 meter tether, but otherwise the experiment is similar to the SP1. And the planned launch of this is next year. And this is proceeding according to plan, so everything is on schedule, everything, all the hardware is being made, and our experiment, I mean, we already have several of these 100 meter tethers, which are in principle flight ready, but we haven't yet delivered them to the satellite people. Okay, so then I'm now in the remainder of the talk, I will discuss E-sail applications, so the interplanetary E-sail applications. So this is a generic method of producing propulsion in the solar system, which is independent of any resources except the solar wind. And as we know, the solar wind flows everywhere except inside Earth's magnetosphere, where we have the satellites. So we can't use this method for raising satellite orbits, for example. But we can use it everywhere else in the solar system. Well, of course, except perhaps Jupiter's magnetosphere, I mean giant planet magnetosphere, but that's another story. Anyway, so we only need the solar wind to work, and then after that we can control the thrust direction by up to 30 degrees, roughly speaking, roughly speaking 30 degrees off the radial direction from the sun, And then the thrust magnitude, it scales as 1 over distance from the sun. And on top of that, we have, of course, 100% throttling capability. So we can reduce the thrust to zero at any point we want, or to any other value between 0 and 100%, by just changing the current and voltage parameters of the electron gun. This system, for example, this system could enable multi-asteroid touring missions. So we could tour the asteroid belt using a single spacecraft without any other limitations except physical wearing down of the equipment. I mean, this is ideally suited to this task because we can generate large amounts of delta V per year. I mean, 30 kilometers per second per year, or even more, depending on the mass of the payload. So we could tour the asteroid belts near Earth. I mean, any asteroids, near Earth objects, the main belt, Jupiter, Trojans, whatever asteroids there are. And of course, we could make flybys or rendezvous. I mean, it's up to the user to decide whether he prefers rendezvous or flybys or some combination of them. Of course, rendezvous are more pricey in the sense that one can make a smaller amount of rendezvous per year than flybys. But of course, they are also scientifically more interesting. So this is would be kind of enabling technology for that kind of mission. And as we know, there are so many asteroids that we don't run out of targets very soon. Then giant planet entry and flyby. So the ESAL could be used as like a booster to the outer solar system at high speed. So it kind of would replace this usually what one uses, the Earth-Venus-Earth gravity assist maneuver, which enables us to launch to outer solar system, I mean with chemical thrusters. The drawback of those maneuvers is that they are time-consuming, so the travel time is 7 years, 6 to 7 years, even longer, for Jupiter and Saturn. With the ESAL, the travel time would be much less, and also the launch window would be quite flexible, because there is no dependency on the gravity assist maneuvers. Then it's again up to the user what one wants to do with this capability. So, of course, flyby is the simplest, the cheapest option. Atmospheric entry is a little bit more complicated, but also quite possible. Then perhaps orbital capture, then one needs some auxiliary chemical propulsion to do that, because we can't break down at Jupiter with this technology or any of these giant planets. But in this sense, anyway, this would be of interest to any of these outer planets. Then there are lots of missions which actually don't involve kind of going anywhere far, but just to remain at some, one just wants to remain at some orbit which is like not natural, which is not non-Keplerian, which is not, which does not obey Kepler's laws, so which require constant thrusting. And one could apply this kind of orbits for Earth, to Earth observation, for example, off Lagrange point solar wind monitoring for space weather forecasting with longer than 1 hour warning time. Or one could watch Earth approaching near Earth objects and so-called pseudo-moons, which are scientifically interesting, but they are just, the bottleneck is how to find them. Also Earth observation, maybe from some high elliptic orbit, whose apogee is locked to the morning sector. Then in the solar system, one could apply this in very many different ways. For example, one could have a permanent view to sun's polar regions to do helioseismology of sun's high latitudes of the sun, or one could study auroras of giant planets, for example Jupiter. So one would stay above the planet sun Lagrange L1 point, and from that kind of vantage point one has a continuous view to the polar region of the planet, so that one gets a real-time monitoring of the aurora of the planet, and one gets a real-time measurement of the solar wind by the same spacecraft at the same time. And this is not possible to do by other ways. And for example, of course, we have very nice pictures of Jupiter and Saturn auroras taken from Earth by Hubble, but they are very rare because usually this pole is not visible from the viewing angle that we have from Earth. So if one wants really to have a continuous time series, one needs to do something like this. Of course, it's also possible to do with traditional methods, but at higher cost and using more than one spacecraft always. Then there is also rather interesting idea, which was not by me, but it was proposed by Joel Ponsi from Thales Alenia Company, so that one could use this easel as something he called data clipper. Essentially, it means a very small spacecraft which has the easel, which returns home from some distant target in the solar system with terabytes of data. So one would put in the small spacecraft a lot of memory, flash memory, to store more data than one could ever radio down from the distant solar system. So the idea would be that one would conduct the mission in the traditional way in real time, obtaining the data by radio waves. But then afterwards, after the mission is complete, one would receive this extra high resolution data, terabytes of data, after a few years after the main mission has stopped, by this small and low cost ESAIL subspacecraft which travels from the target to Earth. Once in Earth's vicinity, how to download this data, it would be done by ordinary radio antennas, because the downloading is very easy from close distance. Then about asteroid mining. This system would be ideally suited for asteroid mining. Of course, asteroid mining is a little bit scary topic to some people, because it sounds like science fiction. However, after 2013, I started to dare to speak about it, because these two companies came into existence, and one of them is funded by Google. So they seem to be serious, and they seem to be looking into this application, how to use asteroid mining to really make a very big change in all of space exploration. I mean, to enable one to make large constructions in space without launching stuff from Earth in an expensive way. So from asteroids one would mine water and other volatiles for use as an impulse for chemical propellant making in space to serve manned Mars activities and other manned exploration. And then platinum group metals one would take use for direct selling on Earth. I mean, the price per kilogram of these platinum group metals is high enough that it might make sense. It might make economical sense to return them to Earth directly for direct selling. And then maybe after that, which is more difficult, requires more infrastructure, one could mine asteroids for other common materials such as iron and nickel, aluminium, silicon, you name it, for making this kind of large constructions in space without launching stuff from Earth. So there are kind of three steps into this kind of business. So I think the easiest thing is to use these volatiles, which just require heating of the material and capturing the evolving gases from the material. And then we can make this manned exploration, in principle, much cheaper. And then platinum group metals is perhaps the commercial selling point, because then you can really generate some profit if you manage to bring some platinum to Earth, down to the surface of the Earth. And then iron nickel is perhaps the most long-term future, because it enables, after all, these large constructions. Then the question is that what is the need for such large constructions? Well, I'm sure people can come up with various exciting ideas once such capabilities exist, but I don't want to go into those details now. Okay, I will almost skip over this slide, but in some sense this ESAIL would be enabling technology for small solar system probes. The reason is that the ESAIL is very flexible, so it can be used, it's sufficient to launch the ESAIL into interplanetary space by any escape orbit launcher. It doesn't matter where the escape orbit is directed. As long as it goes to the solar wind, after that the ESAIL can take over and then take the payload to the destination, and it means that you can launch in principle you could launch multiple probes, multiple ESA probes by the same launcher, and these probes could be designed to completely different targets. One of them could go to Jupiter, the other one could go to Mars. Unlike we have now, that if one wants to launch something to Jupiter, then one needs this initial boost, which is goes towards that planet, and then if one wants to piggyback anything onto that, then that this piggyback payload also has to go to the same planet, and so on. Okay, so here are my conclusions. I will not read them aloud here, but I'm now ready to answer your questions if you have, if such questions have arisen during the presentation. Okay, thank you very much.
Is there any interest in NASA for these good ideas?
Yes, there is, from Marshall Space Flight Center. So they have made an internal proposal to this NIAC, NASA Institute for Advanced Concepts, for some internal funding to study this, to make some laboratory prototyping and then later to make some flight experiment of this system. But this proposal is under evaluation, to my knowledge.
How do you see the potential of negative polarity plasma braking system for standard units to be put on all future satellites, which would be deorbited at a certain moment after they are finishing their activities? You described the system that you just drop the wire down to the Earth's gravity field and then switch on the electricity and you get it done. So is this potential thing to be thought as a commercial thing?
Also? Yeah, it is quite so. So it is potentially quite viable, and we are actually going to discuss this thing in Paris at NES in a couple of weeks with a major European company who is interested in this system and would like to investigate whether this could be put to European satellites in the future. Of course, then the question is that what is the mass of the satellite and the altitude? So if the altitude is 800 kilometers or lower, then and if the mass is not extremely heavy, then it's easier. If the mass is very heavy and if the altitude is more than 1,000 kilometers, then it's still possible, but it's more challenging. So, but there is a large sub. At least there is a, should be a large subset of satellites where this is technically feasible. Let's put it in that way.
I think most of the Earth observation satellites are in orbits of 800 kilometers or less.
Yes, that is true.
While the telecommunication satellites are higher up, so.
And of course, the geostationary satellites—they are a completely different thing. So they are not affected by this.
Creating the same problem as the normal polar orbiting satellites.
I wonder if you could repeat a moment about asteroid mining or exploring. There, we seem to be talking of a different size of object. Size of satellites and therefore propulsion, etc. Can we have an ESAI for asteroid mining for missions that are big enough, as you point out there, to do any significant work in this direction?
So you are kind of asking about the scaling up possibilities of the So. So I would say that this system can be scaled up to about 1 newton level of thrust, of continuous thrust, which allows one to carry about let's say maximum five ton payloads. So if one wants to carry larger payloads, then one needs multiple ESAs. So if one makes asteroid mining of volatiles and water, then it's certainly possible at any scale, but then one needs a fleet of identical spacecraft, which are are kind of hauling this cargo. So it doesn't seem it's not possible to build an e-sail which would carry a manned module, for example, directly. So that is, or let's say, at least with the concepts we have, it doesn't seem to work. Of course, never say never, but I mean, but at least it doesn't look feasible. But I mean, collecting this propellant could be done. Of course, I mean the amount of propellant that you can collect by this method, for example, to Mars orbit for return propellant. Or to high Earth orbit, for example, high Lagrange point Earth orbit, is not limited by anything.